was sitting on the riverbank singing a little song he had just composed it himself, so he was very taken up with it and would not pay proper attention to Mole or anything else. Since early morning, he had been swimming in the river in company with his friends, the ducks. When the ducks stood on their heads suddenly, as ducks will, he would dive down and tickle their necks just under where their chins would be if ducks had chins, till they were forced to come to the surface again in a hurry, spluttering and angry and shaking their feathers at him, for it is impossible to say quite all you feel when your head is underwater. At last, they implored him to go away and attend to his own affairs and leave them to mind theirs. So the rat went away and sat on the riverbank in the sun and made up a song about them, which he called Duck's Ditty. All along the backwater, through the rushes tall, ducks are a-dappling. an easy chair while the mole took another by the side of him and made some civil remark about Toad's delightful residence. "Finest house on the whole river," cried Toad boisterously, "or anywhere else for that matter." He could not help adding. Here the rat nudged the mole. Unfortunately, the toad saw him do it and turned very red. There was a moment's painful silence. Here today, up and off to somewhere else tomorrow. Travel, change, some lunch," he said diplomatically, "and we'll talk it over. We needn't decide anything in a hurry. Of course, I don't really care. I only want to give pleasure to you fellows. Live for others. That's my motto in life." During luncheon, which was excellent, of course, as everything at Total always was, the toad simply let himself go. Disregarding the rat, he proceeded to play upon the inexperienced mole as on a harp. Naturally a voluble animal, and always mastered by his imagination, he painted the prospects of the trip and the joys of the open life and the roadside in such glowing colors that the mole could hardly sit in his chair for excitement. Somehow it soon seemed taken for granted by all three of them that the trip was a settled thing, and the rat, though still unconvinced in his mind, allowed his good nature to override his personal objections. He could not bear to disappoint his two friends, who were already deep in schemes and anticipations, planning out each day's separate occupation for several weeks ahead. When they were quite ready, the now triumphant toad led his companions to the paddock and set them to capture the old gray horse, who, without having been consulted and to his own extreme annoyance, had been told off by Toad for the dustiest job in this dusty expedition. He frankly preferred the paddock and took a great deal of catching. Meantime, Toad packed the lockers still tighter with necessities, and hung nose bags, nets of onions, bundles of hay, and baskets from the bottom of the cart. At last the horse was caught and harnessed, and they set off, all talking at once, each animal either trudging by the side of the cart, or sitting on the shaft as the humor took him. It was a golden afternoon. The smell of the dust they kicked up was rich and satisfying. Out of thick orchards on either side of the road, birds called and whistled to them cheerily. Good-natured wayfarers passing them gave them good day, or stopped to say nice things about their beautiful cart. And rabbits, sitting on their front doors in their hedgerows, held up their forepaws and said, "Oh my, oh my, oh my." Late in the evening, tired and happy and miles from home, they drew up on a remote common, far from habitations, turned the horse loose to graze, and ate their simple supper, sitting on the grass by the side of the cart. Toad talked big about all he was going to do in the days to come, while stars grew fuller and larger all around them, and a yellow moon appearing suddenly and silently from nowhere in particular came to keep them company and listen to their talk. They turned into their little bunks in the cart, and Toad, kicking out his legs, sleepily said, "Well, good night, you fellows. This is the real life for a gentleman. Talk about your old river." "I don't talk about my river," replied the patient rat. "You know I don't, Toad. But I think about it," he added pathetically in a lower tone. "I think about it all the time." Reached out from under his blanket, felt for the rat's paw in the darkness, and gave it a squeeze. "I'll do whatever you like, Ratty," he whispered. "Shall we run away tomorrow morning, quite early, very early, and go back to our dear old hole on the river?" "No, no, we'll see it out," whispered back the rat. "Thanks awfully, but I ought to stick by Toad till this trip is ended. It wouldn't be safe for him to be left to himself. It won't take very long. His fads never do. Night." The end was indeed nearer than even the rat suspected. After so much open air and excitement, the toad slept very soundly, and no amount of shaking could rouse him out of bed next morning. So the mole and rat turned to, quietly and manfully, and while the rat saw to the horse and lit a fire and cleaned last night's cups and platters and got things ready for breakfast, the mole trudged off to the nearest village, a long way off, for milk and eggs and various necessities the toad had, of course, forgotten to provide. The hard work had now, after the cares and worries and fatigues of housekeeping at home. They had a pleasant ramble that day over grassy downs and along narrow bylanes, and camped as before on the common, only this time the two guests took care that Toad should do his fair share of work. In consequence, when the time came for starting next morning, Toad was by no means so rapturous about the simplicity of the primitive life, and indeed attempted to resume his place in his bunk, whence he was hauled by force. Their way lay, as before, across country by narrow lanes, and it was not till the afternoon that they came out on the high road, their first high road, and their disaster, fleet and unforeseen, sprang out on them. Disaster momentous indeed to their expedition, but simply overwhelming in its effect on the after career of Toad. They were strolling along the high road easily, the mole by the horse's head, talking to him, since the horse had complained that he was being frightfully left out of it, and nobody considered him in the least. The Toad and the water rat walking behind the cart, talking together. At least Toad was talking, and Rat was saying at intervals, "Yes, precisely. And what did you say to him?" And thinking all the time of something very different, when far behind them they heard a faint warning hum, like the drone of a distant bee. Glancing back, they saw a small cloud of dust with a dark center of energy advancing on them at incredible speed, while from out of the dust a faint boop boop wailed like an uneasy animal in pain. Hardly regarding it, they turned to resume their conversation, when in an instant, as it seemed, the peaceful scene was changed, and with a blast of wind and a whirl of sound that made them jump for the nearest ditch, it was on them. The boo-boo rang with a brazen shout in their ears. They had a moment's glimpse of an interior of glittering plate glass and rich morocco, and the magnificent motor car, immense, breath-snatching, passionate with its pilot tense and hugging his wheel, possessed all earth and air for the fraction of a second, flung an enveloping cloud of dust that blinded and enwrapped them utterly, and then dwindled to a speck in the far distance, changed back into a droning bee once more. The old gray horse, dreaming as he plodded along of his quiet paddock in a new raw situation such as this, simply abandoned himself to his natural emotions, rearing, plunging, backing steadily in spite of all the mole's efforts at his head, and all the mole's lively language directed at his better feelings. He drove the cart backwards towards the deep ditch at the side of the road. It wavered an instant, then there was a heart-rending crash, and the canary-colored cart, their pride and their joy, lay on its side in the ditch, an irredeemable wreck. The rat danced up and down in the road, simply transported with passion. "You villains," he shouted, shaking both fists. "You scoundrels, you highwaymen, you road hogs. I'll have the law of you. I'll report you. I'll take you through all the courts." His homesickness had quite slipped away from him, and for the moment he was the skipper of the canary-colored vessel, driven on a shoal by the reckless jockeying of rival mariners, and he was trying to recollect all the fine and biting things he used to say to masters of steam launches when their wash, as they drove too near the bank, used to flood his parlor carpet at home. Toad sat straight down in the middle of the dusty road, his legs stretched out before him, and stared fixedly in the direction of the disappearing motor car. He breathed short. His face wore a placid, satisfied expression, and at intervals, he faintly murmured, "Boop, boop." The mole was busy trying to quiet the horse, which he succeeded in doing after a time. Then he went to look at the cart on its side in the ditch. It was indeed a sorry sight. Panels and windows smashed, axles hopelessly bent, one wheel off, sardine tins scattered over the wide world, and the bird in the birdcage sobbing pitifully and calling to be let out. The rat came to help him, but their united efforts were not sufficient to right the car. on his face, his eyes still fixed on the dusty wake of their destroyer. At intervals, he was heard to murmur, "Poop, poop." The rat shook him by the shoulder. "Are you coming to help us, Toad?" he demanded sternly. "Glorious, stirring sight," murmured Toad, never offering to move. "The poetry of motion, the real way to travel, the only way to travel. Here today, in next week, tomorrow, villages skipped, towns and cities jumped, always somebody else's horizon. Oh, bliss. Oh, boop, boop. Oh, my. Oh, my." "Oh, stop being an ass, Toad," cried the mole despairingly. "And to think I never knew," went on the Toad in a dreamy monotone. "All of those wasted years that lie behind me, I never knew, never even dreamt. Shall spring up behind me as I speed on my reckless way. What carts I shall fling carelessly into the ditch in the wake of my magnificent onset. Horrid little carts, common carts, canary-colored carts. What are we to do with them?" asked the mole of the water rat. "Nothing at all," replied the rat firmly, "because there is really nothing to be done. You see, I know him from old. He is now possessed. He has got a new craze, and it always takes him that way in its first stage. He'll continue like that for days now, like an animal walking in a happy dream, quite useless for all practical purposes. Never mind him. Let's go and see what there is to be done about the cart." A careful inspection showed them that even if they succeeded in riding it by themselves, the cart would travel no longer. The axles were in a hopeless state, and the missing wheel was shattered into pieces. The rat knotted the horse's reins over his back and took him by the head, carrying the birdcage and its hysterical occupant in the other hand. "Come on," he said to the mole. "It's 5 or 6 miles to the nearest town, and we shall just have to walk it. The sooner we make a start, the better." "But what about Toad?" asked the mole anxiously as they set off together. "We can't leave him here, sitting in the middle of the road by himself, in the distracted state he's in. It's not safe. Supposing another thing were to come along." "Oh, bother Toad," said the rat savagely. "I've done with him." They had not proceeded very far on their way, however, when there was a pattering of feet behind them, and Toad caught them up and thrust the paw inside the elbow of each of them, still breathing short and staring into vacancy. "Now, look here, Toad," said the rat sharply. "As soon as we get to the town, you'll have to go straight to the police station and see if they know anything about that motor car and who it belongs to, and lodge a complaint against it. And then you'll have to go to a blacksmith's or a wheelwright's and arrange for the car to be fetched and mended and put to rights. It'll take time, but it's not quite a hopeless match. Meanwhile, the mole and I will go to an inn and find comfortable rooms where we can stay till the cart's ready and till your nerves have recovered their shock." "Police station. Complained," murmured Toad dreamily. "Me complain of that beautiful, that heavenly vision that has been vouchsafed to me. Mend the cart. I've done with carts forever. I never want to see the cart or to hear of it again. Oh, Ratty, you can't think how obliged I am to you for consenting to come on this trip. I wouldn't have gone without you, and then I might never have seen that swan, that sunbeam, that thunderbolt. I might never have heard that entrancing sound or smelt that bewitching smell. I owe it all to you, my best of friends." The rat turned from him in despair. "You see what it is," he said to the mole, addressing him across Toad's head. "He's quite hopeless. I give it up. When we get to the town, we'll go to the railway station, and with luck, we may pick up a train there that'll get us back to Riverbank tonight. And if you ever catch me going a-pleasuring with this provoking animal again—" He snorted, and during the rest of that weary drudge, addressed his remarks exclusively to Mole. On reaching the town, they went straight to the station and deposited Toad the second class waiting room, giving a boarder